property, the value should not exceed $75,000. If it exceeds $75,000, then you need a specific approval from Reserve Bank of India. The property can be only commercial or residential in nature, as we understood, that you cannot give to a farmhouse or agricultural property. A foreign national of non-Indian origin resident outside India cannot acquire any immovable property in India by way of a gift. So a person who cannot buy something directly, he cannot acquire something indirectly also. And therefore, this regulation. As far as acquisition through inheritance, so I always wonder that this is something which is automatic. Why, what was the need for this specific provision? But then if you notice, there are citizens of Bangladesh and Pakistan, when and on the minute reading of that notification will fit, that when they have inherited that property, it's not that property gets transferred automatically in their name. Again, you may need to approach, that is our interpretation, that you may need to approach Reserve Bank of India. And many times there are issues, because who is the person who has actually inherited also, that needs to be found out. So Reserve Bank would examine and may grant the permission or may ask that person to dispose of the property. So NRI PIO or foreign nationals of non-Indian origin can inherit and hold immovable property in India from a person who was resident in India. However, citizen of Pakistan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Afghanistan, China, Iran, Nepal, Bhutan should seek prior approval of the RBI for holding or transfer of inherited immovable property in India. So even for holding, they may need approval, and they would again, when they want to sell, they will not be able to sell unless there is a permission given by the Reserve Bank of India. NRI PIO or foreign national of non-Indian origin can inherit an immovable property from a person resident in India or a person resident outside India. However, the person from whom the property is inherited should have acquired the same in accordance with the FEMA law in force applicable at the time of acquisition of the property. So if you inherited from a person who has committed some violations, then obviously you may be in difficulty, yes.
Inheritance through succession or through will?
See, so long as he is able to prove that he is the legal heir, right? So one of the case could be that will is always challenged. If it is a case for will or succession, what we have seen is that RBI would maybe insisting on a probate.
Bangladeshi or the Pakistani whose forefathers, that is three generations back, they were the Indians.
Correct.
They have inherited the property, let us say in Kutch or maybe in on the border.
Correct.
What would be the situation? Whether the land could be inherited or transferred in the name of those people or not?
No, I have a question for you. Suppose in a similar situation, a person is trying to sell the property, and suppose you are the buyer, what kind of documents you would insist? Would you straight away go on the basis of the document that he furnishes to you and say that, look, I am the legal heir of this property, so please buy it? Will you buy that property?
No.
My question is, so when Reserve Bank steps into that shoes, when anything that requires Reserve Bank of India's approval, Reserve Bank, see, what is misunderstood at times is that when Reserve Bank grants you the permission, the buyer, poor buyer will understand that this means all the approvals are given by Reserve Bank of India. Reserve Bank is not a competent authority to advise you on other succession issues. So Reserve Bank says, if any approval under any other law is required, then you better take that approval. But generally, the buyer, poor buyer will understand that since Reserve Bank has given the approval, it is a clear-cut case, and many buyers can buy that. But normally, we advise that you get proper probate. Otherwise, even the buyer, if it happens to be our client, we would not advise him to buy this kind of a property. So Reserve Bank also would like to have proper documents in hand, unless based on the document that you are the only heir. If you are able to prove that you are the only heir or successor.
Two, three heads also, and according to the letter of administration or probate, whatever is applicable, it has been obtained, in that case whether they will be able to, the reservation will be able to object to that, since he is a non-resident Indian, you cannot transfer it.
No, Reserve Bank generally, if proper documents are given, Reserve Bank will not question the authorities. But in one case, you are saying, yesterday only I had an opportunity to examine a case where the grandfather was in India, in undivided India, and he died. And his two sons are now Pakistani citizens. And they have given some kind of notary document. They have said that you kindly help me in getting Reserve Bank of India approval. But I said, where is the letter of probate? A proper document, because once we upload Reserve Bank of India, Reserve Bank will ask the questions that whether these two persons are actually the real owners or there is third person also involved. So that aspect you have to satisfy. Of course, this is not my subject and I am not an expert on that subject, but I would go by the common sense. Any buyer who wants to buy that property, you would like to be extremely careful. Even in Bombay, we have seen a person dies and there are two heirs, and even when it is given in the will, many times people insist that you please get a proper will, unless there is a nomination in the society record file. Because the nomination is filed, the nominee is entitled to dispose of that property. Or nobody wants to fall in the dispute. So this could be a case where there are lot of, some disputes may arise. Nominee is a trustee. But he is the person nominated to deal with the property. So he can deal with that property. If nominee has disposed of that property, the other person who claims to be also the heir has only right on the proceeds. He cannot stop the nominee from disposing of the property unless he brings a stay from the court of law. And that is my understanding. But we are digressing from the subject, so let us stick to this subject.
Combined reading of this slide and the previous slide, can it be concluded that a national of non-Indian, foreign national of non-Indian origin cannot get any gift of a farmhouse, but he can inherit a farmhouse in it?
True. Yes. Is it? Yes. That's true. But is
farmhouse defined?
No. Farmhouse is not defined. So, but there also we have seen plannings, because we have seen that there are married daughters outside India and they want to buy properties in India, and they go to their parents or brother, the parents who are actually very old, and money is given by them. The parents buy those farmhouses, and they provided the will that this will go to my daughters. See, this is a perfect planning, but we many times advise that under FEMA, you should not plan, because there is no appeal on what Reserve Bank of India, Exxon Reserve Bank of India will take. If Reserve Bank says that you have overdone it, probably Reserve Bank may not allow you and may ask you to dispose of this kind of properties. So one has to be extremely careful in planning under FEMA.
Sir,
yes.
In your example which you gave right now, the profit should be.
Let me tell you, I am not an expert, but since the heirs are lying, both the heirs are in Pakistan, probably they can go to Indian court also, because the subject matter is in India also. Property is in India, so they can go to a court in India also. The father died in Pakistan. He died in Pakistan, but he had acquired the property when he was. He was part of undivided India. So property was in India, he has to take a property in India. So that is a process probably you will have to do.
There's a conflict stand also.
Yes. But that is not my cup of tea, so I better refrain.
There is a classic case in Jinnah's bungalow in the Pinsir.
Yeah. Yes, yes. So coming to the transfer, NRIs can sell property in India to a person resident in India or a NRI or PIO. So while NRIs are free to transfer to resident, NRI or PIO, but when you come to PIO, there is a slight difference. Let us understand, they can transfer to a person resident in India, NRI or PIO with the prior approval of RBI. So I am not able to understand the logic, but when a PIO is selling a property, he cannot sell to another PIO unless there is a specific approval from the Reserve Bank of India. So that aspect one has to keep in mind. Foreign vessels of non-Indian origin, including citizen of Pakistan or Bangladesh or Sri Lanka, so these eight countries can sell property in India with prior approval of RBI to a person resident in India, and NRI or PIO, when say RBI approval, you can sell to anybody. So there the PIO is included, because ultimately you are not able to sell without the Reserve Bank's approval. Now, transfer of property by NRI PIO, foreign vessel to gift. Now, NRI PIO can gift property to person resident in India or NRI or PIO. A foreign national of non-Indian origin requires prior approval of RBI for gifting residential commercial property. So if it's a pure non-Indian origin, then you have to approach RBI even for the gift. NRI PIO can gift an agricultural land or plantation property or farmhouse in India only to a person resident in India who is a citizen of India. So this aspect has to be kept in mind, that by gift you cannot give agriculture or plantation land to another NRI. Or even a person when is a resident of India, he has to be a citizen of India. A foreign national of non-Indian origin would require the prior approval of RBI to gift agricultural land, plantation house or farmhouse, that we have seen. Now coming to the mode of payments, NRI or PIO can pay for immovable property out of funds held in India through normal banking channels or fund held in NRE, FCNRB or NRO accounts. So sometimes you may have local funds also, you can buy property out of your local funds also, or you can use your deposits in India, or you can remit money from outside India. But no payment can be made either by traveler's check or by currency notes. So suppose he has come and he has carried some currency, he cannot pay through those currency. He will have to then that even deposit with NRE or motor account. And out of that he can issue the checks. He cannot directly use those traveler's checks or currency for payment. Coming to the repatriation of property, this is one area that people book and then cancel. And sometimes genuinely, and sometimes they book with a view to cancel and ultimately make a profit. So this is one area which is, though the regulation permits, but one has to be very, very careful that if you are doing on a large scale, this may tend out to trading in real estate. So what this regulation says, NRIs PIO are allowed to credit refund of application money, earnest money deposits, purchase condition on account of non-allotment, cancellation of bookings for purchase of residential commercial property, together with interest, if any, net of income tax payable thereon to NRE FCNR account, if originally paid out of these accounts, or if it is paid out of NRO, then it can go to NRO account, subject to the satisfaction of the authorized dealers. So this regulation is meant for those genuine investors. But there, we have seen cases where people are booking 10 properties at a time with 10 different builders, and then they are cancelling those properties and they are getting the money back. Maybe there is some back-to-back arrangement. The person is not interested in buying that property. The person is interested in making quick buck out of the boom in the real estate sector. Here one has to be extremely careful, because if it is up to an extent, it is all right. Otherwise, if it goes beyond a certain limit, then this may tend to amount to trading in real estate. So as I said, that you should not purely interpret the notification as it is. You may argue with this notification in front of Reserve Bank of India, and Reserve Bank can still take a different stand. So that you have to be careful.
So the current example what you mentioned, continuing from the same one, there is already a person who has n number of properties in India, all over India, just for purpose of making capital gains, he is invested. He does not want to take the allotment or the possession, and does not only want to enter into the agreement, because that will attract stamp duty and everything. So right before, as the property is ready, or in between only, he plans to sell it off. Now, with 10 properties, where do I draw a line saying that, okay, you're already having 10 properties and this will tantamount to trading activity? Where do we draw the line?
It's a very difficult question to answer. And it goes along with the Reserve Bank of India's economic policy. As we go along, we'll see. that there are a lot of NRIs who are holding agricultural land in India. And when we had asked question last time, or even Bombay Chartered Accountant Society had organized this kind of a seminar with United occasion to ask to CGM this question, that what NRI will do this with property, suppose there are mango plantations or some, so you are not allowing us to do agriculture activity. He answered that, well, what NRI will do, you will have to definitely maintain those trees and do some cultivation activities. So what he said was not strictly in accordance with the FEMA regulations. Now, few years back, the same question I had posed before earlier CGM. He said, no, FEMA does not allow you to carry on any agricultural activity. So this FEMA law is such a law which Reserve Bank slips over. Let me tell you, there are a lot of enabling powers under FEMA. One should not be under it, because Reserve Bank is not doing anything, does not mean that Reserve Bank does not have a power or it is allowed. And many people advise their clients and they are getting running away. And Reserve Bank is doing nothing. That does not mean that Reserve Bank cannot do. Right? This is an economic power. Reserve Bank will slip over till the time Reserve Bank feels that it benefits the economy or it does not damage the economy, and it is done for a genuine motive. If it is done in a large scale, then Reserve Bank feels that it's come to a point whereby it is damaging the economy. These are the enabling powers. Sometimes we feel that you cannot. We have been seen, we have been representing to Reserve Bank that you cannot offer normal courtesy, hospitality to your NRI relatives. Sometimes you cannot make small payment on their behalf. Reserve Bank keeps on always answering. Where you show us the case where we have taken the action. And we go and narrate few small incidents. But those are the cases where real violations have happened. So Reserve Bank does not exercise those enabling powers till the time Reserve Bank feels that this is damaging the economy. So when Reserve Bank will draw the line, we do not know. But it would be very difficult. It's a genuine case if you are able to explain for the reserve. But if he keeps on buying every year, if it's a trend, he keeps on buying and selling. Or say there is no difficulty, Reserve Bank is also slipping. But one day, we do not know what will happen. And I'll give you another classic example. Earlier, there were a lot of technical violations, in the sense that people were not intimating within 30 days. When you come to this FDI, you will know that you have to file intimation to Reserve Bank of India that it is an inbound investment within 30 days of receipt of those funds. And within 6 months, you have to allot the sales. And on allotment of the sales, another 1 month, you have to file FCGPR forms. Earlier, people were slipping, they were not filing. And then Reserve Bank also said that they were furnishing wrong statistics to IMF and World Bank. So in between, they said that please, otherwise we'll start taking action. So when we were regularizing those transactions and filing for compounding, Reserve Bank was not levying any penalty for compounding charges. And things were moving smoothly, so we advised many of our clients that please go for compounding. And for several years, Reserve Bank did not do anything. Then suddenly one fine day, Reserve Bank woke up and they started levying huge penalties. And ultimately Chamber had to represent, stating that this has become a money-making business for Reserve Bank of India. And then Reserve Bank again liberalized those compounding provisions. So it will keep on varying. We do not know when Reserve Bank will back up. If it is a need of an hour, then Reserve Bank will back up. But there are plenty of enabling powers with Reserve Bank, which Reserve Bank slips over. Let's proceed further. Now, coming to repatriation of sale proceeds, it is an immobile property other than agricultural land, farmhouse, plantation property in India by NRI or PIO. It shall not exceed the amount paid for acquisition of the immobile property in foreign exchange received through normal banking channel. So what it says that you cannot repatriate profit, and we have to understand what you mean by profit. And the amount paid out of funds held in foreign currency non-resident account or through foreign currency equivalent of the amount paid where such payment was made from the funds held in non-resident external account for acquisition of the property. And in case of residential property, the repatriation of sale proceeds is restricted to not more than two such properties. I mean, two such properties, we again fail to understand. Yeah, two means two in the financial year, two in the in the lifetime of a person. There are no clarifications. People are remitting money is going and coming out. Reserve Bank is doing nothing. But the regulation is not very clear on that aspect. repatriation shall include crediting the proceeds to an account denominated in foreign currency or to account of an Indian currency maintained with an ADI. So all of us, we know that any credit to NRE account or FCNR account is as good as repatriation, because once that money is credited to those external accounts, the Reserve Bank will lose the control. So it is freely repatriable outside India. Now, I have given an example of the repatriation. Here is a case where NRI has invested $2 million. At that time, the rate for long it was 45 rupees. So it was almost 9 crore rupees that he had invested in buying a property. Then, when he sold it for 24 crores of rupees. And presuming that the rate is 60 rupees, he bought almost $4 million. So there was in rupee terms, there was a gain of say 15 crore. And I, for the sake of convenience, I have calculated tax at 4.5 crores. So there is a net of tax gain of 10.5 crores. Now, when we talk about $2 million, see, at that time it was 45 rupees, now it is 60 rupees, so he can actually remit $2 million, that is 12 crores he is free to remit. And balance 7.5 crores. So 7.5 crores out of that 1 million, that is 6 crore he can remit under a $1 million scheme. And balance 1.5 crore is not repatriable, means it's not repatriable during that year. Maybe he is able to repatriate in the next year, because this scheme is for per year. Now, as we have seen, whether two properties in a year or in a lifetime of an investor, that is not clear. But people are requesting the bank, and banks are repatriating. The NRI is also sometimes buying, then repatriating, again buying. That is a benefit they have given to our own people. And Reserve Bank would like to slip over till it does not reach to a level where it is damaging the economy. The slip over, this is only my interpretation. So this is not something that Reserve Bank has said. But from our experience, we are saying that RBI will continue to slip over till they feel that it is benefiting the economy. Now, if you originally acquired out of your NRO funds, then the amount of capital gains, if any, arising out of the sale proceeds can be credited to the NRO account. And out of that NRO account, you can take advantage of $1 million scheme and repatriate up to $1 million every year outside India. Now, coming to renting of residential or commercial property, NRI PIO can rent the property without the approval of RBI. The rent receipt can be credited to NRO account or NRE account or remitted abroad based on the appropriate certification by a chartered accountant, subject to that 15 CA, 15 CB formalities. Now, holding of immovable property bought when a resident after becoming NRI PIO, a person who had bought the residential or commercial property for agricultural land, plantation property, farmhouse in India, then your resident can continue to hold those property even after becoming NRI PIO. Now, coming to carrying on of those agricultural activities, as I have said, that per set is not permissible, but if you can make out a case that what I will do with those trees which are standing in the farm, now Chiku plantation is there, or something is there, then probably if you can make a case, it is recommended that you bring that aspect to the notice of Reserve Bank and seek specific approval. Because as I said, the policies keep on changing with the change in the personnel also at the Reserve Bank. Now, coming to the gentleman's question, whether a foreign company can buy a property in India. So there is a general permission to purchase immovable property in India by branch office or other place, or other place of business, because the foreign companies, either they will set up a branch office or some project office or a liaison office. Now, liaison office is not allowed to buy a property in India, except the lease not, which is not exceeding 5 years. Subject to applicable laws, rules, regulations or directions, which may be issued from time to time, and a declaration has to be filed in form IPI within 90 days from the date of such acquisition with RBI. So this is the only incident of immovable property where you need to file a declaration with the Bank of India. Otherwise, no declarations in case of removal properties are required to be filed with the Reserve Bank. So whatever we have discussed so far, that I have put in form of a table, and there is nothing new in this table. So I think that unless there are any specific questions, we'll skip this table. Now coming to immovable property abroad, an Indian citizen resident in India cannot acquire or transfer immovable property outside India without RBI approval, except by purchase out of RFC accounts, funds or out of foreign funds acquired as a non-resident. So that person who was a non-resident and he has returned to India and he is holding some money outside India, because the persons who are returning are also allowed to retain money outside India. But if they want to bring it to India, they can keep still part that money in resident foreign currency account. So a person resident in India can is free to buy property outside India from these two funds, or he can get as a gift or inheritance from returning Indians. He cannot acquire by way of gift from any other person. So resident in India cannot acquire as a gift from a third person. If third person is willing to give a gift, it is not possible. Foreign citizens who are Indian residents are free from any restrictions regarding immovable property transaction outside India. So there are lot of persons who are acquired foreign citizenship. Once they are foreign citizens, there are plenty of US nationals who are residing in India. Those US nationals who are residing in India are free to buy any property outside India. Of course, Reserve Bank does not release foreign exchange, but if, by any chance, if they are able to have some source of funds outside India, they can buy the property outside India. An Indian resident can transfer the above property as a gift to his relative, who is also an Indian resident. So if Indian resident has got a property outside India and he wants to give to another relative, he has to be a resident in India, then he can gift away the property. And here relative has a very restricted meaning. That includes spouse, brother, sister, Indian ascendant or Indian descendant. So not that it includes a very vast list of relatives. Yeah.
So the term returning Indian is defined?
Returning Indian is not defined. So okay. Returning Indian means you'll have to actually make a declaration at the custom that he's migrating. And then when he comes on migration, there are some benefits. Earlier there used to be certain benefits at the custom level also, including he can bring a car also. I don't know, duty free. Currently I'm not actually keeping track with those kind of regulations. But those are the cases where he is actually migrating. Not a case that he comes and stays, buys a house and stays for a few years in India.
So if
he was
born in UK, married to India, she has a property from her father's side in UK. Can't she inherit it?
She can.
It doesn't come under your second.
No, you. This is a acquisition. I am talking about acquisition of the property.
There is also a gift for inheritance.
Inheritance we have seen earlier that if you want to, we'll go further. But if it is a case of an inheritance, there is no problem. If it is a property from the father's side, you inherited and father falls into Indian ascendant.
But so if that, returning
Indian. No, that is fine. That is fine. She can inherit that property.
And sir, that RFC account would include RFCD also?
No.
Only play.
Only RFC which you earned while you were non-resident, not RFCD. Now you are able to open RFCD account. So that doesn't mean that you can use that money to buy a property outside.
Sir,
no.
Sir, but for that funds from RFC account also, now under LRS you cannot acquire immovable property. So even if I have funds which are in RFC or
RFC means, as he said, RFC means it does not include RFCD domestic. By RFC means the RFC when you are NRI, you have acquired certain funds which you have parked in resident foreign currency account, which you are otherwise entitled to keep it outside India.
But today I am a resident.
Yeah, but it was the extent was acquired by you while you were non-resident.
So that I can
that extent you are free to utilize to buy a property outside India. Because you are not under a compulsion to bring that to India, but you prefer to do that. So it was a kind of a, when country was in need of funds, the Reserve Bank came out with the scheme, then you bring it to RFC account, we will allow you to limit as and when you want. That's how they